Thank you. Welcome, everybody. So, is the sound okay? Video for Linux 2. Well, first of all, I absolutely hate the name Video for Linux 2 because it's a mouthful, but it was all decided way before I started. Yes, there was a Video for Linux 1. It no longer exists. It's been removed from the kernel. It took many, many years, but it is gone. Basically, this is the successor of the API with improvements, and there were bad design mistakes made in version 1, and so that's why there is a version 2. But the name itself is horrible. Just to give, it's basically the opposite of DRM. DRM is for video output. This is everything else. So main thing is video capture. Yes, we can also do video output in very specific situations, but you won't normally see it. Memory-to-memory devices, think of scalers, color space converters, but especially codecs. Encoders, decoders for video compression and video decompression, which is actually the main topic of my talk, because there has been a lot of things happening in the last year, year and a half. Other things, you can have metadata, vertical blanking interface, you don't really see that anymore, this was the standard television. Things like teletext, closed captioning. The media controller, media devices, they are fairly new. They give insight in the topology of complicated hardware. A low-level device, so you can directly control a sensor. Radio, surprisingly, yes, that's part of Video for Linux, because Video for Linux really started with TV capture cards. And a radio capture card is basically a TV capture card without the video. It's still a tuner, you still have to do all the same things, except you don't actually have video. Even touchpads, because if you have, normally, if you have a touchpad on the laptop, the hardware will translate the presses that you do into actual higher level higher-level protocol, but some touchpads are really low-level, and they basically just expose your pressure points as an image. So there are a few of those touchpads that are using Video for Linux to just expose the data, and then you need software to post-process it. Interesting. But as I said, my main topic is hardware codec support, and step one is to understand what is happening. There are some very basic things that are very important for the talk. So when you want to encode a video, you give raw frames, the raw images, and they are encoded one by one. And the first thing that you create is intra-coded picture frames, iframes. And that is basically, you effectively make a JPEG out of it. More complicated, but that's basically what you do. It's standalone compression. It's not dependent on anything else. But then you get B frames and P frames. So P frames are only dependent on the iframe. It's basically the difference between that frame and your original iframe. So you only encode the difference. So that means that you can get a much, usually a much smaller, much better compression ratio. B frames, they are actually dependent on an iframe and a P frame. So they are bidirectional. And they can actually achieve still better compression. This example, you just have an iframe to B frames, P frames. Usually you have more P frames than B frames. B frames are useless when you do video conferencing. And if you think about it, it makes sense. Because you can't decode a B frame until you have both the I and the P frame. So that will take time, so it will increase the latency. And that really delays your video. So if you have video conferencing, you only have iframes and P frames, and never B. But if you make a Blu-ray disc, then there are no latency issues, and it's much more important that you can achieve really good compression. So then you get B frames. Not all hardware decoders can handle B frames. Some only do P frames. They're really geared towards, you know, mobile phone and video conferencing. So there are two types of hardware codecs. The first one we have supported for a very long time now, 5, 6 years, I'm not sure, We call them stateful codecs. Basically, you give the raw frames or the compressed data, and it will just process it. You don't need to know anything else. You for the decoder, you give it the byte stream, and out come the raw frames. The hardware keeps the state. You don't. It's very easy to use. You don't really need to know anything. Of course, this gives overhead for the hardware. And normally, so some of the hardware decoders, you can really just give it a random byte stream, and it will handle it. It will parse where the frame starts and where they end and everything else. There are some decoders that are not quite that fancy. There you actually still have to parse the byte stream software and find the frames themselves and the metadata that describe how the frames should be decoded. In practice, GStreamer, FFmpeg, they all do that. So they pre-parse the byte stream into the frames plus any headers, and they give that to the decoder. One thing that was missing when this was added to Video for Linux was a really detailed description on how you handle corner cases. How do you do a seek inside the stream? How do you handle midstream resolution changes? You can do that. So applications like GStreamer, they sort of looked at what specific hardware could do, and they worked around it. But we really needed to have a detailed specification, and that's being written. It's very close, actually, to have the decoder spec in particular to go in. I hope to do that in the next 1 or 2 weeks. Most of it was written by Google, the Chrome OS team. They're really keen to get this precisely defined. And the other part that we've been working on is testing. This is complex, especially corner cases. So we did a few things. First of all, we've done that for other areas, for other drivers as well. We created a virtual codec driver, so it emulates a codec. It actually has its own codec. It was written as a university project because we needed to have an... You can't just insert an H.264 encoder into the kernel. Some small things like license fees, and not a good idea. So we wanted to have a codec that was representative of actual codecs, had definitely no patents, was short, reasonably fast, and we didn't care about the quality. It just to test this. It was actually a fun project. So that's in the kernel. And we use this for prototyping APIs, see what works, what doesn't. And we have a compliance test utility that actually tests the API, and it also tries to test all these corner cases. So that helps you. The plan is actually that for various codecs in the future, we have test scripts that you can run and test for regressions. Now, that's all fine, but you know, this is stateless codecs. That means that the hardware needs dedicated memory. It needs to keep state. It's way more complex to process. And of course, hardware designers are cheap. They don't want to do that. So they created stateless codecs. Basically, what you do is you give it the frame to decode. Any other information that you need, all the headers, the metadata is all parsed and is handled together with the frame to the hardware. The hardware decodes that frame and gives you an updated state back, and then it loses the state. So everything you need to do in software. The problem was we didn't have support for that, because one of the things that this requires is per frame configuration, because you give the frame and you need to give state, and they belong together, and we never had that. This is something that we wanted to have for other reasons as well. So Android Camera Hull, it uses the same mechanism that you can, per frame, you can change things like brightness, white balance, whatever, autofocus. So we needed it anyway, and we wrote an API for that, but that took ages, and I'm not going into it. It would make a very interesting case study on how not to do things. Anyway, we worked finally on the request API, and we got that in, so we can now do this. The main thing is we do that for stateless codecs. stateless decoders, stateless encoders, we don't have support for that yet. It will come in. We don't expect many problems, but I'm ignoring that for this discussion for now. Again, just as we had for the stateful decoders, we needed documentation for stateless decoders, also written by Google. And again, testing. So we had Daphne Hirschfeld did an outreachy project to add stateless decoder support to the visual codec driver. She actually also did stateless encoder, but that's not in. Again, because we don't have actual hardware and we want to know how does an actual driver do this. We don't have the compliance tests yet for this. That will be written at some point. So the request API framework, that was the main blocker for this. That's now in, came in beginning this year, I think, or end of last year. And now we have two stateless drivers for it, the Cedrus drivers for all WinRAR SoCs, and the Huntro driver. It's an IP that different SoC vendors have bought. So we have implementations for Rockchip and IMX8 Freescale SoCs. I believe there are some all-winner SoCs that use it as well, but we don't have any support for that yet. The codecs that we support at the moment are MPEG-2, H.264, and VP8. HEVC support, aka H.265, is being worked on. Patches are floating around. VP9 is planned, but I haven't seen any patches yet. This is all still in staging. The reason is that it's complicated. It's complicated anyway, video encoding and decoding. So we want to give it some time for the API to mature and make sure that we didn't forget anything before we pull it out of staging and put it in mainline. It's looking all very promising, but there are definitely some things that still will have to change. Yeah, for this one I need to have a drink. Request API that's been cursed. So, stateless codec, stateless decoders has been around for quite some time, and Google needed it for their Chromebooks because a lot of them are based on Rockchip. Rockchip is stateless, so they needed support for this. So I think how many years ago? 4 years ago by now, perhaps five, I wrote what is called the configuration store API. That's basically a predecessor of the request API, and it allows you to associate some state information with the frame, and then just give it to the hardware. That worked great, and actually Chrome OS have been using that for years internally. But it got never mainlined because it was a solution for a very specific use case. It was not generic enough. Because the same thing we also need for camera home. If you want to do similar things on Android, you need a similar mechanism, except that you'd be way more powerful. It was too specific for one particular use case. So I wanted to get this into the kernel, and then I got feedback, yeah, that's okay, but it's not generic enough. I will work on it. Well, 2 years later, nothing was done. Are you going to work on this? Yeah, but okay. In the end, that didn't happen, and Google got impatient, and they took over the project. Unfortunately, through no fault of their own, they didn't quite understand the additional requirements that they had. They were too focused again on this specific use case. So every solution they came up with, they got basically the same feedback. At one point I just said this is enough, and I took over, worked on it for a few months, and basically made it generic enough. It's still not fully featured enough to do an Android type solution. But it's way closer. It would need another 10% of work, But then you really need to be working on that use case in order to figure out what the missing pieces are. The main API is generic enough to handle it. So this really should have been in years ago, but because of all political and sociological and time constraints, lack of money, whatever you want to call it, it just took a very long time. So basic concept of the request, actually the name request is borrowed from Android. Nothing new under the sun. You make a request object, you add all the state information plus buffers to it, you queue it to the driver, and the driver can process the whole thing as an atomic blob, atomic piece of information, and program the hardware accordingly. Sounds easy, it's way harder to implement. So it's currently only used by stateless decoders, but the intention is that it will be extended to complicated camera pipelines as well. So what do you put into a request object for a stateless codec? You put in the buffer that you want to decode, and you put in what we call controls. Controls are a standard feature of video for Linux drivers. Initially, there were simple knobs like brightness from 0 to 255, and saturation, and out-of-focus Boolean, so simple numbers. But later, we added support for arrays and compound controls, basically structures, so you could provide lots more complicated information inside the control. But it's a basic building block of video for Linux. And the state, we use set through controls. The interesting thing is about decoders, video decoders, the algorithm to decode an image is standardized. You cannot really deviate as an as hardware from it, because otherwise you wouldn't get back what the encoder intended. You start messing with the output. So how to decode a byte stream is standardized. It's in the standard. So that makes it much easier to create the controls, because you only have to look at the standard. You don't have to know about different hardware implementations. Or at least, we hope we don't. So you have to create different controls for different codecs, different standards. But otherwise, they are hardware independent. Good, so how do you do this? Step one is, as I said, you need to make a request object. So you do that through a media controller device. So every stateless decoder will create a media controller device. That one is chosen because for a complex pipeline, camera pipeline, you will have lots of different devices for all the blocks in the pipeline, but you will have one media controller. For a stateless decoder, you just have one video device. So it does make less sense, but this is more generic going into the future. Anyway, you have a media file descriptor, you say request, allocate a request, and you get it back as a file descriptor. So it's represented through a file descriptor, which means you can do ownership permissions. It's easy to work with. Normally, for every allocated buffer, so say an MPEG stream, you may want 12 buffers. I don't know, random number. For each buffer, you usually create one request file descriptor. So you just associate it with the buffers. One very important consideration to make with stateless codecs. For stateful codecs, you just give it the byte stream, and it will handle everything. Stateless codec, you need to do a lot more. You need to know a lot more about how it is decoded. So in particular, so iframe is easy, right? So you give the header an iframe, the compressed iframe, and you give it to the hardware decoder, and it will decode it for you. But you can't give it a B-frame next, because the B-frame depends on the iframe, you have that, and a P-frame. But you haven't given that yet, so it can't decode it. So actually, what you need to do in a stateless decoder is you give it the iframe, then the p-frame, then you can give it the b-frames. So your presentation order in which you present the frames to the on the display is different from the decoding order. So you need to as an application you need to do a lot more work. Next step, so we need to give the buffer to the request object. So we do a few things. First of all, you have the buffer type, it's output. Now, this is always confusing everybody. VIA for Linux is from the point of view of the application. So you fill application fills a buffer with the compressed frame, and it outputs it to the hardware. The hardware decodes it, and you capture the result. If we would rewrite VIA for Linux, we would probably start talking about source and sync, but it's 15 years old, so you just need to know this. So in this case, we have a compressed buffer, and that's an output because we want to output it towards the hardware. Next, you set a flag saying that this is for a request file descriptor, so you don't give it to the hardware yet. You store it in the request. You set the request file descriptor. That's the request you want to store it in. Then you set a timestamp. Now this is talking about the buffer tag. So going back here, take this P frame, you need to refer to the I frame because it's the difference, it contains the difference between this frame, the actual frame, and the I frame. This also means that you need to have a way to refer to decoded frames. Because the iframe is easy, as I get, you have the compressed buffer, it's decoded, you get it back. But the P frame needs to refer to that decoded iframe. And we do that through timestamps. I'm not entirely happy with that. I would have preferred to have a separate tag field for it. But it was a long discussion, and in the end, people decided, okay, we want to keep it in the timestamp. So this is not actually a timestamp anymore. It's just a placeholder for a tag. State controls will refer to that tag through a U64, and you use that function to translate the timestamp to that U64 reference value. And finally, you call the qbuff. This queues the buffer to the request object. So now the request object has this buffer. The buffer has a tag. And what will happen when it's decoded? The tag, the timestamp, will be copied to the capture buffer. So the capture buffer and the output buffer will have the same tag. Important to remember. So state information. I hope it's readable, but it's not that important, actually, what it's saying. So first of all, there's the define. That's the define for the control. This example is MPEG-2, because it's the easiest. And the control takes MPEG-2 slice params. That is all the information, all the state information that the hardware will need. This is all part of the MPEG-2 standard. You see all these references to the actual standards. So we don't invent things. This is basically a one-to-one mapping of what is in the standard. Most important part in RAD, there are two reference, backward reference and a forward reference. So those will refer to which reference frames, iframe or P frames, this frame depends on. And you fill that in by using this value for the right buffer. So this uniquely identifies a buffer. And what you will end up with when the hardware is going to decode this frame, it will actually, of course, it will, you will DMA the compressed data of the frame that you want to decode. It will be DMA to the hardware. But the hardware will also look at the decoded iframe and P frame that it depends on. So it will DMA that as well. This is actually nothing different from a stateful codec. A stateful codec does the same, except the driver will either allocate a pool of memory where the stateful codec will store those decoded frames, or it will have its own associated memory. Except here it is explicit. You're very explicit at what you are doing. Also note that one advantage of this, the stateful codec will make copies of the decoded frames. Here, you will directly access the decoded frames themselves. So it's actually, I have to be careful. It might be more memory efficient, let me put it that way. So, all the data in the state controls, they must relate to the standards. You cannot invent things. There must really be a one-to-one mapping. This also means that an application doesn't need to know what hardware the decoder is running on, because it's not using any hardware-specific information. It's all the same. Any VPA decoder will use the same structures. Applications parse the byte stream, they fill in the structures, they fill in the buffer with the actual compressed frame data, and then they pass it on. Same controls as I said it already. If there are hardware decoder-specific controls, then they have to be specified separately. We haven't encountered them, but hardware inventors are not to be trusted. So it might happen. So this is how you would do it in adding the parameters, the header data, to a stateless decoder. You have the structure for the slide params, you fill them in. You fill in the right references to the reference frames that it depends on. So these, again, these are translated to the actual addresses of that decoded buffer in memory. And this is all boilerplate stuff. Here you say that you add the control to a request and not set it directly. This is again the request file descriptor. So this adds the state information to the request objects. The capture buffer, so where you receive the decoded frame, you need to queue that. That's not going to the request object. The request object only contains the output buffer, so the compressed buffers. Here you queue it, so now the driver has the request and can process it. You can wait for an event on the request file descriptor that signals when the whole request is processed. Once you receive that, you decode the buffers, the output buffer, because you're done with it, the capture buffer contains the decoded frame. And you will also see that the timestamp of the capture buffer is identical to the timestamp of the output buffer. It's copied inside the driver. And the buffer reference that you, so the buffer reference that you got here from the output buffer when you filled it in actually now refers to this capture buffer. So now you can use this reference in the next B frame or P frame that you want to decode. So this is an example how it would look like. The iframe, you tag it with value 1. What value you pick there is random. Right, you usually it's just can 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 for the number of buffers that you have, as long as it is unique. For the B frame, well, next you actually queue up the P frame, so you give it tag 2, and backward reference is that of that one, the decoded version of that. So now the hardware can decode the P frame because it has the decoded buffer of the iframe. And it can calculate the difference and generate the picture. Same for the B frames, except there you have both forward and backward reference. So you go on through the chain step by step. It all looks probably a bit complicated, but that's what happens when hardware just offloads the complexity to you. I mean, they couldn't be bothered, so now you have to do it. Just the way things are. Okay, so now before I go to the second topic, which is testing, first of all, I want to say, so this is in progress. Quite a few bits and pieces are in. We hope to get it fully into the kernel by 5.4 kernel, perhaps 5.5 if you're lucky. I do want to say that it's been an amazing experience for me, because there's a lot of interest in this. So we have an actual cooperation between companies like Bay Libre, Bootlin, Pangutronics, Collabora, Google, GStreamer folks, Libre ALEC folks, Linaro. I might have missed one or two. So there are lots of people involved in this project. They all either work in the core support, or they test do testing, or they adapt applications for it for testing that the API is good enough. And this has been an amazing experience. It's sort of the complete opposite as to request API, which was very painful, but this is going very smooth, and it is so much fun to see all these people from very different companies working together to make a really good API. And this allows applications to just use a single API to do all their decoding work and encoding work. That's what we want. So kudos to everybody who is involved in this. So the second bit shorter topic, testing. Video for Linux API is very complicated. There are about 100 ioctls, perhaps more. The new ones are being added all the time. This just reflects that media in general is very complicated. And people always want to do new things that we didn't think of. Again, hardware developers, they're all insane, and they just do their thing and never think about the poor software people who have to support it. So we try to be future-proof, but we never quite are. We don't do too bad, but as I said, they're insane. So one of the things that we try to put in a lot of time is testing, improving testing. And it really is three different components. One problem is that a lot of corner cases are in hardware that is difficult to find. So as a tester, you just can't afford to have all the different hardware devices that are supported by VDF Linux on your desk. It's a nightmare. So what you really want is to have sort of idealized hardware that you can use to test all these corner cases, all these various combinations. So that's why we are making virtual drivers. They are really important for us, because it allows everybody to either test their application, to do prototyping, to test rare combinations that you otherwise can't find. It's been a really big success for us. It's a lot of work, but it allows you to test combinations that otherwise are almost impossible to obtain almost impossible to find in real hardware. So we have Vivid, that was the first one. This is really for emulating webcams, TV tuner cards, HDMI video, it does vertical blanking, all the things that are fairly rare these days. It has radio, software-defined receivers, HDMI, CEC is even emulated. So this is the typical scenario of capturing video in all the various combinations. It has an emulated scaler, it can crop, it can compose it in any combination, it has error injection, so you can test rare things like someone unplugging a device, does the application handle that correctly. This is actually being used in prototyping, so when you bring up a board, you don't have support for the video capture yet, but you want to start testing, then you can configure Vivid to actually look like what your hardware will be. VI M2M, that's a typical memory-to-memory device. It has some color space conversion. I think it can do some scaling these days. So it emulates a device like that. VI MC, courtesy of Helen Koik, who did that as an outreachy project and is still maintaining it. So that emulates a complex video camera device, like an OMAP3 or that was the first that we actually had of that type. So you can emulate that. And the new one is then VI Codec to emulate codecs. These are critical. We use regression testing for this. So we run them every so often against the latest kernel, making sure that everything keeps working. And they're actually part of kernel CI testing right now. So there's a QEMU environment where they are being run. The other part is compliance tests. So we spend a lot of time on the V402 compliance test that actually goes through all the APIs and tests all quarter cases, well, as many as we can. I think on the Vivid it does 1,500 different tests or something. So it grew over the years. It started out really small, but it's now quite big, and it does a really good job. And if you post a new driver, I need to have a clean bill of health from V4L2 compliance. You have to fix all the issues. The other part, having virtual drivers, is fantastic to do documentation. Because you have this together with the compliance test, because they are sort of together, right? The compliance test, you figure out how to do corner cases. Those corner cases have to be documented as well. And while you're making the test, you realize, hey, there's a corner case we didn't think of. We need to document that. So it all belongs together. And SysBot, SysCaller, the fuzzing checker from Google is very useful. We don't have enough time, unfortunately, to really fix those issues. So volunteers are welcome. Some resources, documentation of the API. I maintain a version with all the codec specs included, because they're not yet merged. So you can look there to find those. Our Git repository for the driver's media tree. There's an example from Bootlin for the all-winner stateless decoder for how you use it. V4O utils repository that we maintain in tandem with the Git repository. It contains the compliance tests and Swiss Army knife tools, and you can use it to control video for Linux devices. Mailing list, IRC channel information you can find there. There's a page, we're always looking for volunteers. So if you're interested in doing a project for Video for Linux, let me know. Don't just pick an item there, because there might be people who are also interested and they go first. So just contact me what you want to do if you're interested in something, and we will discuss it. And my email. No questions, I think.
1 minute.
1 minute. One question. Nobody scared. Asleep. Ah, there we go.
Hello.
Hi.
So first, thank you for the presentation. So
thank
I'm
you.
Not an expert on video, but just because you were showing us the user space API, and you are talking about the hardware with stateless idea, that the complexity has now gone through for the software. But I imagine, maybe I'm wrong, that's why I'm asking, that from the user space point of view, we're going to pass this complexity to the driver in the kernel space?
Or not?
The user space
no.
is going to have to?
There are good reasons for not doing that. So theoretically, you're right, you can do that. The reason you don't want to do that, first of all, you really shouldn't doing byte stream parsing in a kernel. That's just a really bad idea, if nothing else, because it's too easy to make bugs and get buffer overruns and just complexity that doesn't belong there. But the other bit is that there is a lot of art in parsing a byte stream. So if you do video conferencing, for example, what happens if you lose packets? How do you handle that? And a lot of the added value in how you process broken streams, how you handle that, that's a value-added stuff. You don't want that in a kernel. Different companies want to handle that in different ways. Like Cisco, we do in our video conferencing equipment, we do a lot of work on that. How do you hide missing packets? The network can't keep up, how do you do that? So there is a lot of actual knowledge, a lot of things that vendors want to do there. So you don't want to have it in a kernel. That's really something where you can add value-added stuff which is good to sell. That's why it's not done.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Hans.